to this edition of Mid-South Wrestling Television Network. I'm Boyd Pierce, your host, and I'm telling you we have a tremendous card this week, but want to tell you the continuance of the $1,000 Persian Club contest between Precious Paul Ellering and the Iron Sheik. Ted DiBiase, the North American Heavyweight Champion, will wrestle. Bob Roop and Bob Orton Jr. will be in a tag team match. Ryan Blair takes on Paul Orndorff. And the dream match, you have just 2 weeks left to send in that dream match, the match that you, the fans, want to make. Send it to the television station in which you're watching this week's program. They'll forward it on to us. And the match with the largest number of votes will be the match you'll see the first week of taping in January. Remember, the American Dream Dusty Rhodes will be in the area. Andre the Giant, Op and Sika, the Samoan Warriors, will be coming off of their suspension. Ted DiBiase, you name it, send it to us. Our guest commentator of the week, always the expert, whether it's in the ring or out of the ring, the Oklahoma Stampeder, Cowboy Bill Watts.
Well, I guess, Boyd, what you mean is I always have an opinion. It doesn't mean it's always right, and probably a lot of times it's wrong, but certainly I'm going to voice it. And, of course, things are hot and heavy as 1981 rolls down and 1982 gets ready to kick off. And only 2 more weeks, like you said, and I was talking to Grizzly Smith, and the mail has been really heavy, and some of the matches really show that the fans, there's certain things they want, and this is the one time in 2 weeks they're going to get to be in Grizzly's shoes and make the match, and it should be an exciting thing. Like you said, with Andre the Giant and Dusty Rhodes, we have some exciting news about Dusty Rhodes, a great thing for Mid-South sports. And so without any further, let's get to the matches in the ring.
Right. Opening introduction, Richard Bowden.
And it's tag team action for 1-4 with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 275 pounds from Eastern Europe, Jerry Novak. And his partner at 228 pounds from Alexandria, Louisiana, Ricky Ferrara. In the blue corner at 265 pounds from St. Joseph, Missouri, Mike George. And his partner at 235 pounds, Carlos Zapata.
Our first event to start off this week's action, tag team match, Jerry Novak and Rick Ferrara versus Carlos Zapata and Mike George from St. Joseph, Missouri. Alfred Neely called one man from each team. It's Rick Ferrara and Mike George. Here's Bill Watts.
Well, this wasn't originally signed to be this way. Mike George is not teamed with anybody except the Junkyard Dog. But the dog's been having some knee problems, no thanks to a couple of the opponents he's had in recent matches. You know, whenever you get titles like the dog has, all of a sudden he's got one half of the Mid-South tag title along with Mike George. And then he beat the Great Kabuki in New Orleans for the Louisiana title. It's almost like you become a magnet. You start really attracting the action, and Dog was attracting all the action and was the real center of all the pressure to start with. Now with those titles, he's in a pressure cooker. And, of course, Mike George is teamed with Zapata. He didn't want to cancel the match. He wanted to go on with it, so he's out there against Rick Ferrara and Big Jerry Novak. Mike George, who was very courageous in a tremendous main event here last week against Bob Roop. You know, the credibility of the match because of the tremendous competition just shows what an awesome contender Bob Roop is. He's also an opportunist. Novak stepping in. He's a big, huge man. And of course, Mike George was Zapata's his partner. Zapata's an unknown, but certainly he doesn't have the class as far as the wrestling on Mid-South to really become a backup man for Mike George. You know, you need to know who's on the other side. That's not taking anything away from Zapata, but there's just a tremendous difference. And so, and Mike, it's an unknown, and it's really like being out there on your own. And right now, Rick Ferrara and Jerry Novak have Mike tied in the ropes and are really taking it to him. They're really hammering him. Of course, the referee, they're both on him, and Zapata being the unknown, he sure hasn't come to help him out. That's the one thing you miss. If the dog was there, he'd never let him gang up like that. Looks like Zapata's finally said at least sticking his nose in there to try to help out, but he was short work with Big Jerry Novak just taking, throwing him out. Mike George in a lot of trouble right now. Mike George is fighting back. He knows he can only count on one thing in this match with it. Is that counting on his own power? Ricky Ferrara came out and he slams Zapata on that concrete floor. So Mike George is on his own against two people. But Mike pulled one out of the old bag of tricks right there, and he saved himself kick by Mike George. Mike George showing what it's made out of. Former North American champion. Referee Albert Neely count the foul.
Mike George doing his best when he's against two men in the ring, getting the victory for he and Carlos Zapata. We'll be back after this word from Mid-South Wrestling Television Network.
Last week marked the return to the ring wars of one of the most colorful, self-styled individuals wrestling's ever seen, the precious one, Paul Ellering, coming off a six-month knee injury where he'd had to have really intricate surgery. But Paul Ellering, being the guy he is, he worked out constantly, and he doesn't look like he's lost any form. And he stepped right back into the thick of things, saying he challenged the Iron Sheik and the Persian clubs. And, of course, everybody knows Paul is a very fit man, and it looks like he's mastered the Persian clubs. And last week, everybody was for Paul Ellering as he did 50 repetitions with the Persian club. Let's relive that moment right now.
Earlier in this program, you saw an interview with precious Paul Ellering, who is just returning after 6 months out with an injury. Precious Paul Ellering wishes to accept the challenge that has been issued by General Skandor Akbar and the Iron Sheik pertaining to the Persian clubs. Now, as you recall, the challenge was that the Iron Sheik could do twice as many repetitions with the clubs as any other professional athlete. If he could not double the number of repetitions that any other athlete could do, then he would forfeit $1,000. Precious Paul Ellering thinks that he can do just that. So before we go into this next event, Precious Paul Ellering wishes to accept that challenge. So let's just see if he can indeed do as many repetitions as the Iron Sheik. And he's getting all set, primed for this event.
It is Paul Ellering now with a challenge. Remember, whatever he does with the Persian clubs, the Iron Sheik will have to do twice as many or pay him $1,000.
Boy, I've certainly been looking forward to seeing this all night. I'm looking forward to seeing anybody
two,
take
three,
on this challenge.
4, 5, 6, 7.
Look at him.
Boy, he's
eight,
going with a two.
Nine,
boy.
Look at the fans 10, are going wild
11,
here.
12, 13,
also,
14,
the Iron
15,
Sheik and
16,
Skandor Akbar.
18,
stirred up. Look at his hands on his hips. The General Akbar, he can't believe it.
24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 45, 46, 47, 48, 49, 50. 50 repetitions. How about that now?
I don't know how many.
That means
but
that
a
if
lot
the Iron Sheik cannot do 100, he will forfeit that $1,000.
We've got a wrestling match. We're still in the wrestling business, you know, with Frank Monte. But we'll do it after we beat Frank Monte. And I'll even up the bounty. $2,000 and maybe 200 more repetitions. But first things first, Frank Monte.
Very well. You heard it. He will accept this challenge after this event.
And of course, the rest is history. The Sheik did beat Frank Monte. But then this general, Skandor Akbar, apparently is not as confident of the Sheik's ability to do double the number of 100 repetitions with the Persian clubs. And he actually stalled out the remaining time, as you so avidly pointed out. But you're right, Grizzly Smith did book it back here and said the challenge has been issued. He's done 50 reps. So the Sheik has 100 reps to do, and they're in the ring waiting to finish the challenge for $1,000, which Akbar has personally doubled to $2,000. Let's see what happens.
Let's go to the ring.
Well, last week right here, you saw Precious Paul Ellering take up the challenge of the Iron Sheik on the Iranian Club exercise, and he did.
Let it be known that the general is a welcher. As promised, we'll show you what a real man can do with a Persian clubs.
Well, Precious Paul Ellering did 50 repetitions, so now it's up to the Iron Sheik to do 100 or more. So count along with me, fans, and let's see if the Iron Sheik can do that. He's getting set now, and here he goes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21. 2, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 7, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 5, 46, 47, 48, 49, 50, 51, 52, 53, 54, 55, 56, 57, 58, 59, 60, 61, 62, 3, 4, 5, 57, 58, 59, 60, 61, 62, 63, 64, 65, 66, 68, 69, 70, 71, 72, 73, 74, 75, 76, 77, 78, 9, 80, 81, 82, 83, 84, 5, 86, 87, 88, 89, 90, 91, 92, 93, 94, 95, 6, 97, 98, 99, 100, 102, 1. And he did. He did over 100. He did 103. So there you have it. Precious Paul Ellering has been defeated with that Persian club exercise.
You know something, Reeser? Last week, Precious Paul did 50, right?
Right.
And this is this week, right?
Right.
And Precious Paul has made a lot of people happy in a week, right?
Well, I don't know now.
Can you dig it, though?
The Sheik did 103.
All right. Last week was last week. This week is this week. Precious Paul wants to do them again this week.
Well, that would be up to General Skandor Akbar to...
Let's hear what Blender Brain has to say.
Well, there you have it. He's issued another challenge.
He's man enough. It's all right with me.
Okay. Let's see how many you can do this week. He did 103.
And Precious Paul, for 444 days, I had to drink 444 glasses of water. I had to dance with 444 girls, and I had to listen to tie a yellow ribbon around the old oak tree 444 times. I just may go for that.
Well, let's see if Precious Paul can do 444 repetitions. Count along with me, and let's see how many he can do.
Boy, Pierce, the Iron Sheik has just broke in as Paul Ellering was going up over the bark, which was going to force him to have to do over 100. The Iron Sheik has just Pearl Harbored the Precious One. It's about the same type of tactics as the Khomeini and the embassy. Without warning, they struck a defenseless person at the time. The crowd is shouting, USA, USA. The Sheik puts the camel clutch on Precious Ellering with Akbar in there with the flag. Jack Howe trying to come to the aid, thrown out on the floor. The Sheik's got the Precious one at his mercy. Of course, Paul Ellering is a man of no allegiance, so he's in there alone. Ellering's coming up, powering himself up. He's behind the Sheik's leg. Ellering got out of the camel clutch, using that tremendous strength even after all those repetitions with the heavy Persian clubs. The Sheik is firing on him. Ellering is firing away. Ellering's taking control. Body slam. Elbow. Akbar really. Akbar just drove that flag staff right into the abdominal section. Now he's belaboring the Precious one with the flag, the Iranian flag staff. Matchmaker Grizzly Smith ought to get another referee out there. Sue play. Precious Paul Ellering, a man alone. Reliving history right here. Alfred Neely, another referee in the ring. Akbar finally seemingly letting the Sheik vent his vengeance and has pulled the Sheik out. Ellering, a man.
While things simmer down, we try to get it under control. We'll be right back after this word from Mid-South Wrestling.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit in the red corner. At 248 pounds from Tampa, Florida, Paul Orndorff. And in the blue corner at 232 pounds, also from Tampa, Florida, Brian Blair.
Action continuing now. Two top grapplers, both men hailing from the state of Florida. Brian Blair versus Paul Orndorff.
About the treatment of the Precious Paul Ellering at the hands of Khomeini's former personal bodyguard, the Iron Sheik, and the General Skandar Akbar. Ellering is a man alone out there. So the contest with the Persian clubs remains unresolved at this point. It was not an official match, so I don't think Grizzly Smith can sanction a fine. And we're right back with a dogfight with Brian Blair and Paul Orndorff. Blair, known to have capability of using the figure four leg lock. I don't know if he has enough skill perfected, enough technique perfected to get it on the likes of Paul Orndorff, former North American champion. I noticed Bob Rufus out there looking on closely, and Bob Rufus, the man that's been coaching Paul Orndorff in breaking Ted DiBiase's figure four leg lock, and also from what I heard last week, Paul Orndorff used the figure four leg lock himself. And of course, it only stands to reason, Boyd, that if you know how to break a hold, you know how to apply it, because you've got to first study it from the angle of applying it so you can find out if it does have a weakness. And of course, 2 weeks ago, we had a time limit draw with Ted DiBiase having his figure four reversed. And Paul Orndorff reversed it on him, and DiBiase held on with such courage. All our hearts went out to him and did not submit in it, which could have a tremendous implication on the North American title. Brian Blair played football at Louisville, while Paul Orndorff was one of the great running backs at the University of Tampa. A lot of personal pride at stake here, a personal rivalry. Paul Orndorff. You know, when the dog and Mike George beat up and Sika, I think they probably thought they'd handled it all, and Paul Orndorff and Terry Orndorff and Bob Orton Jr. and Bob Roop have created a completely different type of threat, a threat that's got its subtleties, a threat that has some real treachery in their technique. They're not the awesome, brutal power like the Samoans. It's more the sly, the mental hassle that they created with Terry Orndorff and the yellow mask, and the ability to shift identities under that mask. So certainly the dog and Mike George's Mid-South tag titles aren't safe as long as Paul Orndorff and Bob Orton Jr. are teamed up, and Ted DiBiase has to watch his every step. With Orndorff, former North American champion, frothing at the bit, and the other one, maybe the most devious and devastating of them all, Bob Roode. Orndorff used a legal form to drive young Brian Blair off. Brian Blair went for a move, but Orndorff was so quick that there Brian Blair showed speed and a quickness of his own. As these men battle, what a feather in his cap if Brian Blair could defeat the former North American champion right here on TV. Ted DiBiase coming up next. Bob Roode, Bob Orton Jr. in a tag. Ed Waskowski, the Iron Sheik, scheduled later to wrestle Don Serrano, a man who shows that he is, without a doubt, has no mercy and no heart, the Iron Sheik. Next week, we're going to show you a tremendous 1981 highlight film. A lot of the exciting action has taken place. Remember, only 2 more weeks for the Dream Match, so be sure to write the station you're viewing now, your cards, your letters, specify Dream Match Wrestling in care of this station. It'll be forwarded to us, and Grizzly Smith will tally them. It's your chance to sit in the matchmaker's seat. And what an array of talent Grizzly Smith has lined up to see which way you, the fan, wants to match them. Real skill and technique out there. Finely conditioned men. Oh boy, Pierce, thinking back, the Sheik looked like that 102 or 3 reps he did was about all he could handle. And if Ellering had done, say, 60 or 70 repetitions, and he was flowing along there pretty good, it would have forced the Sheik to have to do 120 or 140. It might have cost the general $2,000. So they use their treachery to get out of that monetary loss. Beautiful move out there. Oh, and a great move again on Paul Orndorff. This shows why you can never underestimate him, and he's certainly taking credit for showing us by pointing to his head that he was thinking ahead of Brian Blair. Brian Blair was also sticking right in with him, Orndorff punishing him. Well, the competition, it's really a fine line between the top guys as to who wins or loses a match on any given day. You know, it's like two top NFL football teams. It's just a fine line. It can be the attitude, the momentum, so many factors. One thing about it, you never know what will happen between two great opponents here. High knee by Orndorff. Looks like he's got young Brian Blair in a tremendous amount of trouble. Great heart, this Brian Blair, though. I'll tell you, the only way to beat him is to stick his shoulders that canvas for that three count. There he is. Brian Blair fighting back on Orndorff. Like I said before, there's an intense rivalry. There always was between these two young guys who both wanted to be the top dog in the state of Florida. And Brian Blair is showing that he can fight with a little tenacity, too. Of course, Orndorff then raking the eyes. Power slam by Orndorff. His patented move. And Orndorff's going for the figure four. Going for the figure four. Brian Blair kicked him off. Brian Blair kicked him off. He knows the defense. For the best defense for the figure four is to stop it before the man locks it. Orndorff going for the standing suplex. Brian Blair kicked his leg. Orndorff left. Blair suplexed Orndorff. Brian Blair just reversed the hole and suplexed Orndorff. And the crowd is really with him. And Brian Blair knows what he's done. And there he goes.
Brian Blair putting the figure four. He just locked up Paul Orndorff in the figure four. And Bob Rufus screaming and motioning and coaching Paul Orndorff. Paul Orndorff in a lot of trouble. There he goes for that reverse like he did 2 weeks ago here with Ted DiBiase, the North American champion. If Orndorff reverses it, it reverses the pain and the pressure. It's almost like the Indian deathlock. Now you can see Brian Blair starting to get that excruciating pain. Alfred Neely is asking him if Blair won't capitulate. Blair won't submit. He's saying no. But how far can he go? We thought that 2 weeks ago that Orndorff would break the legs of Ted DiBiase, and DiBiase is probably 20, 25 pounds bigger than Brian Blair. Neely asking him. The referee's out. Jack House come out to sit Bob Roop back in his chair and make sure there's no interference. Neely's asking Brian Blair. Brian Blair won't give up. What a heart in this young man. But Orndorff's got it cranked in. And you recall that DiBiase's match was the last match. Television time remaining. DiBiase held on until time ran out.
Now, for Neely, call for the bell, Bill.
Neely's calling for the bell. I didn't.
Well, you see Brian Blair saying that he did not give up.
The people are saying no. But Paul Orndorff won't break the hold. He won't break the hold, and Brian Blair's in excruciating pain. Jack Howe telling Bob Roop to go to his seat. We'll have to get the referee's decision from here.
There you see Alfred Neely conferring with Jack Howe.
Maybe we'll wave at Jack Howe. Maybe we can get Jack Howe over here, Boyd, and ask him.
Jack, the ruling, please.
The referee would like to make it plain that Brian Blair did not give up in this particular instance. He was afraid of further injury to Brian and therefore called the match himself.
There you have it, Bill. Brian Blair did not give up, but referee using his own discretion.
It's a judgment call, and I got to say, it's sad for Brian Blair, but from the position of things and the amount of time remaining, I'm saying they made the right call.
And he could have saved that leg. We'll be back. North American heavyweight champion Ted DiBiase in action after this word from Mid-South Wrestling.
This is a non-title event for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 232 pounds from San Diego, California, Mike Boyer. And in the blue corner at 252 pounds from Omaha, Nebraska, the North American heavyweight champion, Ted DiBiase.
Mid-South Wrestling, Mike Boyer taking on the North American heavyweight title holder, Ted DiBiase. Jack Howe calls for the bell.
I want to say one thing during the commercial break. One of the first people to young Brian Blair to see about him was Ted DiBiase, because I'm sure that he could relate better to the pain Brian Blair was in than any of us. Brian Blair was a courageous man. He never did give up. Referee's decision, a judgment call. I have to say that in essence of the time left and the position Brian Blair was in, that it was a proper call. Of course, Brian Blair, having a fighting spirit, hated to have the match go in the record book, but it is a win for Paul Orndorff. And as Orndorff was leaving, he was hollering, "What? Look at that, DiBiase! Look at that!" Ted DiBiase has to now wonder, with a man having a way of countering his famous figure four leg lock, you know, that's like having a home run ball. Anytime you're in trouble, you had that knockout punch or that home run situation or that breakaway touchdown in that figure four leg lock. And now somebody has come along with a method of neutralizing it. Ted DiBiase has to feel that it could put the North American title in severe jeopardy. And I wonder who is jeopardizing it most, Boyd Pierce. Paul Orndorff, the man that's doing it, or the man that's sitting by, that's devised the counter, the man who is coaching Orndorff, Bob Roop, a man who's shown his treachery and his, but also his tenaciousness and his toughness and his ability to be quite an opportunist and strike at any weakness or any time that an opponent is in a jeopardy position. Maybe he's laying back and let DiBiase and Orndorff tear each other's legs down, and he can walk in and capitalize. So it all it gets really into the chest part or the mental part, the part that Ernie Ladd was so adept at doing and putting the pressure on the opponent. It's some great moves out here between Mike Boyer and the North American champion, Ted DiBiase. Mentioning Ernie Ladd, I'm sure he's chafing at the bit for the Samoans, Afonseca, for the suspension to be lifted January 1. We haven't heard, according to Grizzly Smith, from them. We don't know if they're going to return to Mid-South. We don't know if they return to Mid-South, if Ernie Ladd will be their financial advisor. Ernie Ladd has lost his meal ticket. Of course, his meal ticket, as he says, has always been himself, 6'9", 320, and he certainly is capable. But he's kind of made a low profile recently. Wow, they're sounding off out there as they trade leather. DiBiase with that tremendous range and height. Boyette comes up. DiBiase gives him a high drop kick. I'm sure he's got a ton of incentive right now, and that's a fired up man. Power slam. And DiBiase still going for that figure four. Root and Bob Orton Jr. closely monitoring it from the balcony of their dressing room area.
And they don't have to teach Ted DiBiase how to use the figure four. He's the master of it, and it gains him another victory. We'll be back with the tag team action when we return after this word from Mid-South Wrestling.
It's tag team action now for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 250 pounds from Blacksburg, Virginia, Bob Roop. And his partner at 238 pounds from Kansas City, Kansas, the Mississippi heavyweight champion, Bob Orton Jr. In the blue corner at 250 pounds from St. Joseph, Missouri, Mike Bond. And his partner at 234 pounds from Seattle, Washington, Frank Monty.
Tag team action now. The cheers for Big Mike Bond and his partner Frank Monty, and the jeers and boos for the rugged duo of Bob Roop and Bob Orton Jr.
Boy Pierce, you have a former Louisiana champion out there in Roop. You have the current Mississippi heavyweight champion in Orton Jr. So Orton Jr.'s been kind of a subtle Mississippi champion in that he's defeated anybody he's defended the title against. He's also been involved in a lot of tag matches. He's kind of a catalyst. The man kind of sneaks up on you. He's got that height and that range, the tendon strength, and he's a tremendous athlete. And I think a lot of people that have looked at him at first as the Mississippi title holder were underestimating him because he's always in the thick of the action. Mike Bond's got him down for a predicament. Orton bridges out. Now, immediately having to scramble. That's the hard part about refereeing one of these tag matches. So many people to stay out of their way. I'd say one thing. Ted DiBiase got a lot of courage. He went right back to that figure four. Got a lot of faith in him. I don't think he feels that Orndorff or anybody else can reverse it on him again. He sure showed a lot of finesse and power and confidence as he put it on Mike Boyer and made him say uncle. Bob Roop, a man who showed what an awesome and methodical and well-schooled and the skills and the techniques he has as he took the measure of Mike Roop, former champion, and one half of the Mid-South Tag Team champion here last week on Mid-South Wrestling. Showing that, my gosh, he's not going to sit back and wait. He's going to take it to him. And the crowd shows their appreciation. We'll have Dusty Rhodes here on Mid-South Wrestling and some of the highlights about him and Kabuki next week. Bob Roop going up like to come off, but Mike Bond runs him down and runs him away. But as the referee was distracted, it shows you what teamwork that Ruth is seemingly always the center of, and that the reason I say Orton's a catalyst because he flows in the motion or whatever, and they used it to double clothesline Frank Monty and take the momentum right away from the Monty and the Bond team.
Bob now, Roode back in now.
Right, and he is flat taking charge. That's what I mean. This man will find a way of disabling his opponent. Monty inside cradle, but in behind him was a tag was made with Bob Orton, and I don't believe Bob Roode was holding Monty, or Monty can't get released, and he tagged behind, a legal tag, and he held Frank Monty, and Bob Orton Jr. just guillotined him with that high leg drop. Shows that these men have been a team on some of the occasion, some of the place with the talent and teamwork they have. It doesn't come together all at once like that. Big Mike Johns in trying to really get after Bob Orton Jr. He body slams Orton. He body slams Roode. Side headlock. Orton had driven Monty out on the floor. Crisscross. The tag is made again. And I'm sure Mike Bond didn't see the tag. The referee saw it. Roode is the legal man in the ring now. He's the legal man in the ring. Bond just did a roll-up, but he is not the legal man. Bob Orton is not the legal man. What Roode has just done is legal. It shows the caginess, the animal instinct, and the cunning of these people. Now another tag is made as Roode sets him up for the backbreaker, gives him the backbreaker. He's got a four count to break. On the three count, he backbroke him and got out as Bob Orton Jr. delivered the coup de grace, and there he goes for his patented pile driver. Hard to overcome a team with this kind of skill, this type of teamwork. Makes me wonder, where have these guys teamed so much to get this type of timing?
Well, they took a rule book right down to the last letter of the law to the count, and it resulted in a victory. Bob Roode, Bob Orton Jr., we'll be back with more action after this word from Mid-South Wrestling.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 280 pounds from New York City, the Polish Prince, Ed Wiskowski. And in the blue corner at 240 pounds from Los Angeles, California, Tom Renesto Jr.
Now, Bill, watch two big men in the ring dressed in black, Tom Renesto Jr., and across the way in the blue long tights with the red stars, the Polish Prince, Big Ed Wiskowski.
Match wastes no time. These guys are getting after it. Seems like the mood has been set today that it's dog eat dog out there. Of course, Wiskowski is an unknown, but he's an impressive man. You know, one of the matches that impressed me most was a loss in Wiskowski's record when he wrestled Ted DiBiase, the North American champion, and showed that he was without a doubt a main event wrestler, because that was a tough, tough match, and Ted DiBiase was glad to get out of there with a victory. And then, that loss on his record, Wiskowski came right back the following week and took the major of Jimmy Garvin, who's just about as tough a competitor as they come. And since then, he's just steamrolled a lot of opposition. And right now, he's really powering over Tom Renesto Jr. We got Don Serrano versus the Iron Sheik scheduled to go on. I know how upset the fans are, and they try to blame the referee for the tag situation that went on before us. But everything that Roode and Orton did was, well, as you said, within the limit. It was skimming the limit of the rule book, but it was legal, and the referee was helpless. Let me tell you, ladies and gentlemen, if you get in that ring, and you got to have that referee to bail you out, you don't have any business in that ring. I mean, you know, there's a lot of times, a lot of matches I've been in, where I thought I got maybe a raw deal by a referee. But if I sat down and started blaming my losses on the referee, then I should blame my wins on him too. And that would certainly show that I didn't have any ability and didn't belong out there. So I always just took it with a grain of salt and said, hey, that's the business you're competing in. It's a professional sport. I'm not always going to make the call to make you happy. And you better not get sad or get your dauber down over it. You better get out there and battle, because you've got to win it yourself, so you lose it yourself. drop by Waskowski. Boy, he just dropped right in on Renesto. And Renesto doesn't look like he's got any gas left. Waskowski is just pretty well flat taking it out. He's outgunned from the start. Waskowski with his side backbreaker. There we go.
1-2-3. That's the reason they call him the Polish Prince. The victory goes to Big Ed Waskowski. We'll be back. Don Serrano versus the Iron Sheik after this word from Mid-South Wrestling.
This event is for one fall or remaining television time. In the red corner at 260 pounds from Tehran, Iran, the Iron Sheik.
Now for Dieter called for the bell. The introduction not finished. Don Serrano, the Iron Sheik. Billy never got the introduction.
Yeah, I don't know why Albert Dieter called for the bell, because there was never an announcement finished. The Sheik's just going out. I guess he really feels confident after the way he treated Paul Ellering. He's blasting Don Serrano. Throwing him out of the ring.
That's precious Paul Ellering. Precious Paul Ellering is going to do a little of that digit out.
But he was on the receiving end, and Akbar is a little bit upset. I'm sure Ellering doesn't care whether there's a disqualification or what. It's just work. Don't get mad. Get even.
Akbar is a whole lot upset. There was the turban. He's moving.
Precious Paul Ellering, he's coming to dish it out. He says if they can curl over him, and the crowd, who was kind of thinning out because they didn't think Don Serrano had much of a chance, the ones that stayed got an unexpected treat. Kind of like people filing out in a football game and then turning around and you're wondering in the parking lot, why all the reaction?
There's
1 minute of airtime left, and Paul Ellering is really pounding it. Referee should make the disqualification off this. Akbar's pulling his man out of there. Akbar's driven the Sheik out. He's pulled the Sheik out, and they've turned tail, and they've run, Boyd Pierce.
Leaving Ellering in the ring. Now, ladies and gentlemen, remember, next week, the special 1981 highlight show, and in 2 weeks, the eighth one of the world, Andre the Giant, plus the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes, and we'll find out whether Op and Seek of the Samoan Warriors will return after the suspension. If they do, will Ernie Ladd be their manager? We'll find out in 2 weeks. Till then, Boyd Pierce for our guest commentator, Bill Watson. Goodbye, everybody, for Mid-South Wrestling.